Okay, so I'm Dr. Guardiola. We're going to talk today about asthma, specifically about severe asthma and the different phenotypes. So first, asthma pathogenesis and phenotypes, and then severe asthma definition and a roadmap to manage these patients. A little bit of history while we're waiting. So this is a little bit of history of asthma. Hippocrates, he said asthma are ailments characterized by spasms of breathlessness occurring more frequently in anglers, tailors, and metal workers. You know, he's the father of medicine. The Hippocratic Oath that nobody takes anymore. Maimonides, 12th century after Christ. He was a Jewish that was born in Cordoba, Spain, and then went to Egypt to be the physician to the Sultan, and he's buried in Israel. So he said patient symptoms often start as a common cold during the wet months. Eventually the patient gasped for air and coughed until phlegm was expelled. And he noted that the dry months of Egypt helped the asthma sufferers. So he proposed a clean air for patients with asthma. Of course, back then there was not much pollution. Then William Osler, the father of of the American medicine, internal medicine, he highlighted the following features. Asthma represents a spasm of the bronchial muscles. So with swelling of the bronchial mucosa, often beginning in childhood and sometimes lasting into old age. There's a relationship with exposure to hay, dust, cat, cold. And describes some distinctive features of the sputum, Kirschman spirals and crystals of Leyden. And then jump to 2 years ago, the Global Initiative for Asthma, GINA, and that's the definition of asthma by GINA. Asthma is a heterogeneous disease, usually characterized by chronic airway inflammation. It is defined by the history of respiratory symptoms such as wheeze, shortness of breath, chest tightness, and cough that vary over time, and intensity together with a variable expiratory airflow limitation. Just a definition, but it's pretty good. And pay attention to the heterogeneous disease. So asthma, as we'll talk later, encompasses several phenotypes. So you cannot say just the patient has asthma. It's like you cannot say the patient has arthritis or anemia. You have to be more specific. So the diagnosis of asthma should be based on a history of characteristic symptom patterns that we just described, dyspnea, wheezing, cough, chest tightness, or an exposure to either specific allergens or non-specific triggers, like pollution or other irritants. And you need evidence of, you need evidence of a variable airflow limitation from pre and post bronchodilator spirometry or the peak flow variability or a bronchoprovocation test like methacholine or exercise. And asthma is usually characterized by airway inflammation and airway hyperresponsiveness, but these are not necessary or sufficient to make the diagnosis. So usually we just go by these first 2 points. Talking about phenotypes, molecular phenotypes, there are clinical profiles and then molecular profiles. So this will be a molecular profile, profiling the patients according to the, making the distinction between between TH too high and TH low. T helper cells too high or T helper cells low. Actually, it's a continuum of TH2 airway inflammation. Now they just call them T2 to make it simpler. So you go from low to high, and as you go towards higher T2, you get more airflow obstruction, airway remodeling, and more responsive to inhaled corticosteroids. So that's how you start your, thinking about the phenotypes in asthma. And these are the main markers to diagnose type 2 inflammation in asthma. So you biomarkers. So if you see these biomarkers, I tell you that probably has type 2 asthma. Like if you see the Tour Eiffel is, you're in Paris, or if you see the Brazil Cristo Redentor, you're in Rio de Janeiro, or the Statue of Liberty in New York. So here, if you see this, you say, well, this patient has probably has type 2 inflammation. So the exhaled nitric oxide is elevated more than 20 or so. IgE is elevated, eosinophils. And the eosinophils, you can check them in the blood. And then I think it's more than 150. Or in the sputum, which is a sophisticated technique, is not available here. And then it's more than 2%. Here's a more complete list of biomarkers and their association with treatment response. So the phenom will give us information about a treatment response to these treatments: corticosteroids, antibodies against interleukin 13. Antibodies against leukin 4 or 13 or anti-IgE. The serum IgE there's no association with treatment response, just remember that. There's several papers showing that. That's another biomarker that we don't usually use, periostin, and tells you about or predicts the response to interleukin 3 antibodies or anti-IgE. Blood eosinophil count, oral corticosteroids, response to oral anticorticosteroids or interleukin 5 antibodies, sputum eosinophil count, corticosteroids, antibodies against interleukin 5. Again, this serum periostin is not available here as far as I know, nor is the sputum eosinophil count. But you can work with pheno, serum IgE, and the blood eosinophil. So the most reliable are the pheno and the blood eosinophil out of these three. This is another depiction of asthma phenotype, considering making the distinction between T2 inflammation and non-T2 inflammation, or high T2 or low T2. And then also some clinical features like age at onset, like start as a child, or develop later in life as an adult, or even later in life. Like, for instance, in obesity-related asthma, or obesity-associated asthma. And then also the severity. So here on the T2, high T2, you have the allergic asthma, allergic eosinophilic asthma is called also. And then you have the late onset, which is non-allergic eosinophilic asthma. Then you have the aspirin exacerbated respiratory disorder here, which is not typically it's not an allergic asthma actually. And then you have the exercise-induced asthma. All these are under the high T2 inflammation. And then the low T2, you have this very late onset obesity-associated asthma, mainly in women. So this obese women, you know, late middle age or so, we see them quite often. They came with asthma, they never had asthma before. The good thing is you make them lose weight, they can, you know, improve the asthma. Then you have the smoking associated asthma, which is usually neutrophilic. It's not, as you can anticipate, it's not eosinophilic, it's neutrophilic, the inflammation. And there is another one called pouchy granulocytic, and this one, there's not much inflammation there, neither eosinophils nor neutrophils. And the neutrophilic and the pouchy granulocytic, they're not very well studied yet. Of course, this one, if they quit smoking, it gets better. Here we have the pathways that lead to eosinophilic airway inflammation in asthma. And so there are two, sorry. So there are two pathways that lead to eosinophilic airway inflammation in asthma. This one is allergic eosinophilic, and this is non-allergic eosinophilic. So allergic eosinophilic is what they call adaptive immunity, also called acquired immunity. And this is the innate immunity. So we're born with this one, we acquire this one. So the allergic eosinophilic is depicted here. You see the allergens. They get in contact with the airway epithelium, and the dendritic cells pick up the allergens and take it to the naive T cell. And the naive T cell is going to activate the T2. T helper, two lymphocyte. And it's going to release, remember these numbers because they come in the exams. It's going to release the 3, 4, and 13, am I right? I mean, sorry, 5, 4, 5, and 13. 4, 5, and 13, these are the interleukins released by this activated T helper 2. So 4, 5, 13, remember that. When you take exams, like a board exam, they ask you about this. Interleukins are going to have several effects. They're going to cause the eosinophils to come to the bronchial mucosa. And then the 13 and 4 are going to make the B cells to start producing IgE, which is going to here hook with the mast cells at the receptors here. And the mast cell is going to liberate histamine and other products. So that's so these all these interleukins are going to cause the eosinophilia. We're going to cause the increased mucus. Hyper responsiveness of the bronchial tubes. And then You have on the right hand side, you have the non-allergic eosinophilic airway inflammation. So here there's no allergen, just pollutants, microbes, irritants, etc. So they irritate the epithelium, the airway epithelium. Is the epithelium. It's not like here that the naive T cell releases the interleukins. Here is the epithelium releases these interleukins, the IL-33, IL-25, TSLP, I think it's thymus, stromal factor that they're going to act on the ILC2, which is innate lymphoid cell, innate lymphoid cell, and these activated cells are going to release 5 and 13 interleukins, which is going to cause eosinophilia, which is mucus, bronchoconstriction, smooth muscle hypertrophy also long term. So that explains why some patients, respond better to steroids, like this group or this allergic eosinophilic asthma will respond better to steroids. This one require higher doses. So we've already seen two pathways. There's another pathway, Th17 pathway, that releases interleukin 17, and then some of these, for instance, this CXCLB is a pre-interleukin 8, I believe, that attracts neutrophils, and also this granulocyte macrophage CSF also. So that's the way the neutrophilic asthma is produced. So it's Th17, okay, pathway. These are Th2 pathways, two pathways here, one pathway here. So you see a little bit of the pathogenesis of the of these phenotypes. Here, give you the whole array of phenotypes. So on the left-hand side, you see the eosinophilic asthma, and you use the markers we mentioned to help you diagnose it. The allergic eosinophilic inflammation, the non-allergic eosinophilic inflammation. Here in the middle, a healthy bronchial mucosa. And here, non-eosinophilic asthma. And you have the pouchy granulocytic, very few inflammatory cells here. It's not well studied. They say depends on the muscle cells of the bronchial airways. And then here you have the neutrophilic inflammation, mainly T17, also T1. So it's kind of the state of the art here now. Probably will be becoming more complicated as time goes, but that's for now, that's what we have. This is triggered by allergens. This is not triggered by allergens. This, I'm talking about the eosinophilic asthma. Allergens here, just the irritants, pollutants, viruses, etc. And here tobacco plays a role. Here nobody knows for sure. They say pollutants, oxidative stress, pollutants, oxidative stress. Next we'll talk a little bit about the severe asthma. So this is the definition. By the way, also they ask about that in the boards. About this criteria here. So this is from the European Respiratory Society and from the ATS. The first two authors are Dr. Cheng from England and Dr. Wenzel from the States. So the definition of severe asthma requires that one or both of the following treatments the previous year have been needed, either to prevent the asthma from becoming uncontrolled or asthma that remains in control despite this level of treatment. Okay, so they need either the GINA step 4-5 level of treatment, which will be high dose inhaled glucocorticoid and long and LABA, or leukotriene modifier, osteophyllin, plasma and osteophyllin for the previous year, or treatment with systemic, so oral corticosteroids for 50% or more of the year, talking about the previous year. These treatments are required, so the patient is out of uncontrolled asthma or still has uncontrolled asthma despite the treatment, despite this level of treatment. So to call it uncontrolled asthma, you has to meet one of these four criteria. Poor symptom control. For instance, ACQ is asthma control questionnaire, more than 1.5. Asthma control test, minus 20, that's the one we do at the BA, but they say that this is supposed to be superior or better. Or not well controlled by the GINA guidelines. The other criteria criterion is frequent severe exacerbation, two or more per year, requiring systemic glucocorticosteroids, or at least one serious exacerbation. By serious, they mean patient had to be hospitalized, ICU, mechanical ventilation. And then the fourth criteria is airflow limitation. So after using bronchodilators, the patient shows obstruction because of the ratio here, FEV1, FVC. FEV1 is less than 80% of predicted. So there is obstruction. Now, I'll give you my version of the roadmap. And I give you the roadmap from more extensive from the Israel, Dr. Israel's article in the New England 2 years ago, which is very good. That's the appendix that tells you how to proceed as far as the investigating the patient. So that's from there, among other sources. So first question to ask, does the patient really have asthma? So you have to confirm the variable flow limitation with spirometry, with the bronchodilator, like we usually do. Consider methacholine or exercise challenge test if spirometry is inconclusive. And do exclude other conditions. So differential diagnosis, tumor in their way or foreign body in their way, COPD, bronchiectasis, CF, vocal cord dysfunction, aspiration, recurrent aspiration, patient with GERD. Okay, so asthma diagnosis being confirmed. So you exclude all these diagnoses. So that's the second station on the roadmap. So has the patient received adequate trial of optimized high-dose X LABA? Yes. The incorrect inhaler technique and the poor compliance are the most common cause of poorly controlled asthma. So that's why it's so important to confirm the inhaler technique. And for this purpose, we have now at the BA, we have the lady there sitting in the first room just to check this thing and check the technique of the patient. So show me how you're doing how you use your inhaler. Very important, because many patients don't know how to use it appropriately. And then also confirm the compliance, that adherence to the medication, checking the pharmacy refill records, which at least at the BA is easy to do. Then electronic monitoring, we don't have that available. That tells you exactly how much the patient is using it. And the patient had elevated FeNO, and you check the FeNO, see if it's suppressed. Okay, so that's second station. Third point, you investigate for comorbidities and aggravating factors. So these are medications and drugs, some patients are overusing the short-acting the SABAs, or the patient is using taking beta blockers orally or eye drops, or is taking aspirin or other NSAIDs or illicit drugs. Then exposure to triggers, tobacco smoke, indoor or outdoor air pollution, extreme weather like a lot of wind, etc., or very cold. Occupational, either allergens or irritants. Then allergens, if the patient is sensitized, like pollen, food, dander from cats or from dogs. Moles, usually with dampness in the house. Dust mites, cockroaches. And you check for sensitization, skin pre-testing or specific IgE. Not survey level, the specific IgE specific for dander or for weeds, etc. And then respiratory viruses. So all these are triggers you have to check. Get a good history. Don't just ask if they have a cat, you know, and finish there, because the poor cat always gets blame. The favorite question is, do you have a cat? Do you have carpeting? Because under the carpeting you have mites, you know, and molds. Okay, and then you investigate for comorbidities and aggravating factors. So you have obesity, renal sinusitis, and plus minus nasal polyposis. That's very important, and this usually goes with the these patients who are asthma is provoked by aspirin. Then COPD, so we're going to have the asthma COPD overlap, bronchiectasis, ABPA, OSA, very important OSA, can make the asthma worse, vocal cord dysfunction, anxiety, depression. You have to check the emotional status, then socioeconomic issues. And it's important to check barriers to medication. Sometimes, you know, you prescribe one of these fancy medications and then the poor patient cannot afford it. They give the sample of the last sample the rep brought along, and then when the patient needs to continue taking the medication, he cannot afford it. GERD, very important, that can trigger the asthma. Pregnancy, heart failure. This is just an example, for instance. I found this kind of easy to see, because this is a case of vocal cord dysfunction. Here you see the normally inspiration, you open the vocal cords, but in patients with vocal cord dysfunction, you see the adduction of the vocal cords. No abduction, but adduction. And here, when you do the flow volume loops, you'll see that inspiration is flattened, expiration is okay, telling you there's a variable extrathoracic obstruction. And then see, you investigate for comorbidities and aggravating. I mean, you're still investigating for comorbidities and aggravating factors, but the point number four, is education and health maintenance. So action plan is very important. We always give an action plan to the patients. We have the nurse practitioner take care of that if you don't have enough time. And then, as we mentioned, inhaler technique needs to be checked, because so many patients don't do it well. Then vaccinations, you know, the flu and the pneumonia vaccines, smoking cessation, healthy lifestyle, Mediterranean diet, exercise, good sleep hygiene. Okay, so the next station on the roadmap. The question is asthma in control despite stepping up to high dose X plus LABA? As we mentioned before, in control is when one of these four criteria are met. Either the symptoms are not well controlled, or the patient has frequent severe exacerbation, more than two bursts of systemic corticosteroids in the prior year, or a severe exacerbation requiring ICU and mechanical ventilation. If the answer is yes, that the asthma is normal control, then you add the non-biologic. So you have tiotropium, leukotriene modifier, theophylline, chronic macrolide, or a short course of oral corticosteroids. And then the final station here is if asthma is still uncontrolled despite treatment with high dose X, LABA, and one of these non-biologic we just mentioned, then you have to determine the inflammatory phenotype. You do the allergy testing if the patient has a history of allergy, the IgE, blood eosinophil count, and phenol level, the two main biomarkers of eosinophilic inflammation, eosinophilic asthma. And then here you have the biologic. I think there's another talk. One of the fellows is going to give a talk on the biologics, I believe.
Dr.
Dilap. Dilap. So I don't want to steal your...
It's in Jan, don't forget.
Okay. So that's what we talked about before. So you have here the T2 cell and releases the three interleukins we talk about, the 4, 13, and 5. And here these 4 and 13 are going to activate the B cell to produce IgE that's going to go to the mast cell and liberate histamine. And then interleukin 5, this is the main culprit as far as the eosinophil is concerned. So you have different antibodies for the interleukin 5. These were for the interleukin 4 and 13. And then this 4 and 13 also can cause smooth muscle hypertrophy. There are also antibodies, monoclonal antibodies against this 4 and 13 that can help in this respect, and also have bronchial thermoplasty. One thing I want to make sure you remember, no biologic option are currently available for non-type 2 severe asthma for the high, I mean the low T2 asthma. So for the neutrophilic and for the PAHO-C granulocytic, there are no biologics. This take-home message: 50% of the severe asthma is due to elevated eosinophilic. This eosinophilic mediated inflammation is associated with progressive airway damage. And especially with eosinophilic asthma require systemic corticosteroids that have significant side effects and comorbidities. And just a simple test, which is the CBC, can tell you if the eosinophils are elevated, so it's most likely it's going to be eosinophilic asthma. So just do that. We order a phenotest. We still don't have it at the VA, but it's available here, obviously. This cartoon here is a little bit more complicated than the ones I show you. And this was shown at the European Respiratory Society International Meeting in Paris. Last November, they showed this one, courtesy of Sanofi. And now, in the last issue of the Blue Journal, they used the people from St. Louis, Dr. Mario Castro and his group, place all the different all the different antibodies here, some of them. So these are the targeted therapies, some of them approved and some of them still investigational. So the antibodies against these different these different links in the chain of eosinophilic asthma. These are my people I learned from. Of course, I never met them, to be honest. But these are probably your main sources. So Sally Wenzel, University of Pittsburgh, is big in asthma phenotypes and severe asthma. Some of the pictures I show you are from her. Fan Chong, National Heart and Lung Institute, Imperial College, London, England. Also asthma phenotypes and severe asthma. And then Guy Broussel, he's from Ghent in Belgium, Erasmus Medical Center in Ghent University, and then also Erasmus in Rotterdam. And I learned from him that there are two pathways of eosinophilic airway inflammation. So the one that's related to allergy, and the one is not related to allergy. Questions? Any questions? Thank you.